So very good morning to all of you. Welcome back to the Global Position System class, GPS class. So I think yesterday I have sent you the question bank, right? Which consists of both descriptive and objective. So as from the authenticated sources, it has come to my notice that most of the times the exam will be in the objective using the VMADULAB software, as it is you have experienced in the last semester. So, but external exam will be definitely in the descriptive, and I have already sent the two textbooks and another spectrum series which is consisting of question and answers, that also to the few students mails. I think one to Shivakali Nikita and another to Naidruva. Naidruva and Nikita, are you present in the class? Say yes or no in the chat box. Hello. Yeah, have you forwarded that textbooks to your entire class? Please do that. Okay, don't waste time. Without wasting time, already we have 10 minutes. I spent already 10 minutes. So let us go back to the subject, that is we have been talking about the so GPS signals, right? So we have seen what is called as a navigation message and what is its format. And in yesterday's class, we have already seen some of the important concepts of the C/A code, its properties and its functions. And also seen the power levels of the C/A code, right? And also the despreading technique, despreading and the spreading techniques and the CDMA technique. So up to this we have seen yesterday, right? Say yes or no. Up to this we have completed in our previous class. So in this class, I'll complete totally the unit 2. P code and its properties is there. Signal acquisition is there. So small topics, we'll complete that. So after code division multiplexing. So as we knew that there are two types of carriers are used. One is the C/A code, two types of codes, that is pseudorandom noise codes for the modulation purpose. C/A code and its properties we have completed in the previous class. And now P code. So what are the main functions of the P code? So first one is the increased jamming protection. So when multiple signals are being transmitted and multiple signals are being received or able to receive by the received by the receiver, then there is a probability of the jamming of the signals. So but here the P code bandwidth, P code's bandwidth is 10 times greater than that of the C/A code. C/A code. So it will provide a better jamming protection because it is 10 decibels more protection, because we are using for the reception purpose narrow band filters. Yesterday we have already seen after despreading technique we use the narrow banding filters. So this will provide a better jamming protection usage of the P code in the modulation techniques. The second one is provision for the anti-spoofing. Provision for the anti-spoofing. So first, what is spoofing? Nowadays, you might be encountering in YouTube, if you open, there will be so many spoof videos. So spoofing is done by enemy or some other persons intentionally or unintentionally. They will send a GPS-like signals to the receivers. Then
the receiver must be able to distinguish what is a actual GPS receiver and what is a spoofed GPS signal. So in this purpose, we are using a technique called as the anti-spoofing. So anti-spoofing is nothing but we are using an encrypted P code. So underline this word. So this is prevented by encrypting the P code. So we are encrypting the P code by using some special code. So that the person, whoever is spoofing, that is spoofer, cannot know the encryption process and cannot make the contending signal look like a properly encrypted signal. Thus, the receiver can detect the false signal and decrypt the desired one. So, anti-spoofing purpose, we are using the encrypted P code. So, for encryption purpose, we are using a special code again. That code, we'll learn about that code in the next slide. And the third function of the P code is denial of the P code use. So it is actually the P code is kept in the web. It is in the open literature. It is like the open source available to many users. Whoever have the license, civilian users, military users, or commercial users, anyone can get that P code and use it for the generation of the reference code, and they can use it for the displaying of the signal and make the navigation purpose. Here, we have to provide a proper encryption for the military because they have to deny the usage by the unauthorized properties. They have to deny the usage of this P code by the unauthorized properties. And this use is present in the P code. This is called as the denial of the P code. Deny means we are rejecting the usage of the P code by some unauthorized users. This is provided for the military people by a technique called encryption. An encrypted P code will be used by the military people. Next, and increased code range measurement accuracy. So this will give more accuracy because the other parameters being equal, accuracy range measurement improves as a signal bandwidth is increasing. So P code provides an improved range measurement accuracy compared to the CBIA code, because CBIA code has 1.023 MHz, whereas this P code has 10.23 MHz band. So it has more bandwidth. So they will use both the codes. Simultaneous range measurements are using the both the codes. And it is also resistant to the errors caused by the multipath propagation, because the signal is coping with the multipath propagation. Due to that, the errors may be caused, and this P code usage will make it resistant to the multipath errors. And P code characteristics, how it can be characterized. So it is modulating both the carriers, whereas CBIA code modulates only L1 carrier, we have seen in the modulation techniques, but P code is modulating both the carriers, L1 and L2. And its chipping rate is 10.23 MHz. Of course, we can compare. This is almost 10 times to that of the CBIA code. And it has a period of 1 week. What is the period of CBIA code? It is of 1 millisecond. So you can compare the timings also. So, and it is simultaneously, or it is transmitted in synchronous with the CBIA code, in the sense that each chip transition of the CBIA code always corresponds to a chip transition in the P code. They are transmitted in synchronous, CBIA code and P code, but they have a different frequency ranges and different bandwidths. And here we are using a Y code. So anti-spoofing purpose, I said P code is being encrypted, and that encryption is done by the Y code. The encrypted form of the P code, it is used for the anti-spoofing and denial of the P code to the unauthorized users. And this code is called as the Y code. And how a Y code is formed? It is formed by multiplying the P code by an encrypting code called as the W code. So Y code is nothing but the encrypted P code. How this Y code is obtained? By multiplying the P code with a W code. And to surprise, the W code also looks same as that of the P code. The W code is a random looking sequence of chips that occur at 511.5 kilohertz range. P code occurs at 10.023 megahertz and W code occurs at 511. So there is a 20 P code chips for every W code chips, because P code frequency is very, very high compared to the W code chip. Since both the P code and W code have chip values are same, plus or minus 1, and the resulting Y code has the same appearance as that of the P code. So it also has 10.23 megahertz chipping rate. Next, we'll talk about the L1 and L2 carriers. So what is the main purpose of the L1 and L2 carriers? Of course, we already know this, to provide the accurate range measurements for the precision applications using the carrier phase. Second one is to provide the accurate Doppler measurements, because Doppler effect is used in the navigation purpose. So it has to be very accurate. The phase rate of the received carrier can be used to accurate determination of the user's velocity, because as the signal is being reaching the receiver, its intensity will increase or decrease because it has been transmitted over a long period of time, over a long distance. So there is a Doppler shift. The Doppler shift is to be taken into consideration. So it can be obtained by counting the cycles of the received carrier. It is often used as the precise delta range observable that can materially aid the performance of the code tracking loops. So we will count the number of cycles received, at what intervals they are received. Depending on that, we will calculate the time, and that is used to estimate the Doppler shift. And a history of this is also maintained, so that if any ambiguity means a confused situation is called ambiguity. The word ambiguity you will come across in your digital system design or switching theory and logic, whichever the subject you studied. An encoder, there will be two ambiguities, ambiguity one and ambiguity two. So here also, if any confusion comes, this will be stored as a history. And the use of L1 and L2 frequencies, what is the benefit of usage of both L1 and L2 in the P code? It provides accurate measurement of the ionospheric signal delay. So as we already seen, while the signal is being transmitting from the one of the orbits of the satellite constellations, it has to travel through the ionosphere, where ionosphere is filled with the atmosphere dust particles, it may get traversed. And because of that, some ionospheric delay may occur. So usage of the two carrier frequencies will decrease that delay. So a major source of ranging error is caused by the changes in both the phase velocity and group velocity of the signal as it passes through the ionosphere. So generally the range errors will be ranging from 10 to 20 meters. So if we are supposed to locate a user at this point, it may be plus or minus 10 to 20 meters away, plus or minus 20 meters. So this delay is caused by the ionosphere. It is inversely proportional to the square of the frequency, so that ionospheric range can be estimated accurately by comparing the times of the arrival of the L1 and L2 signals. Because two signals are sent at the same time, we are not confident about at what time it has started and what time it has reached. If only L1 signal is reached, there will be a confusion. So that for a comparison purpose, L2 signal is also sent. And at the receiving end, we will compare the both and we will take the average or whichever is the nearer. And dual frequency operation, because L1 and L2 are operating at two different frequencies. It is to provide the very accurate measurements for the precision applications, mostly in the military purposes, and to provide the accurate Doppler measurements. Of course, this is already studied. And the second one is, it facilitates the carrier phase ambiguity resolution. Because in high accuracy GPS differential partitioning, the range estimates using the carrier phase measurements are precise, but highly ambiguous due to the periodic structure of the carrier. This ambiguity is easily resolved as the carrier frequency decreases. So by using the L1 and L2 carrier frequencies, the ambiguity resolution can be based on their frequency
difference. So there is a frequency difference that makes the correction and provides the system redundancy. Of course, we already said a history of that will be stored for future references. This is majorly used by the military people. So this is all about the signals. So in a nutshell, P-code has majorly three functions. What is? One is the increased jamming protection, provision for anti-spoofing, and denial of the P-code use. Denial of the P-code use by whom? Unauthorized users. Unauthorized parties or enemies, we can say. And increased code range measurement accuracy also it provides. And P-code characteristics, we already have been studying from the beginning, L1 and L2. And that difference and new point here to be understood is the Y code. Y code is nothing but the encrypted P code. So encrypted P code, how do we encrypt? We multiply the P code with that of a W code, which looks similar to that, but frequency is less than half of it. So L1 and L2 carriers are used because of this relative measurements may be done, and it provides accurate measurement of ionospheric signal delay. Dual frequency operation enables us for the precision in the accuracy and facilitates the carrier phase ambiguity resolution and also provides a system redundancy. Next, what are the signal power levels? How much power is transmitted or radiated by the satellite, and how much power is received by the receiver? A signal is transmitted by four satellites as per our trial attraction technique is concerned, and how much signal is radiated there and how much signal power is received at the receiving end. A measure of this is present in the signal power levels. So transmitted at a minimum level of 478.63 watts, that is approximately 26.8 decibel watts. Effective isotropic radiated power, I think you might have already studied this in microwave engineering, EIR. Which means that the minimum received power is the same as that would be obtained if the satellite radiated 478.63 watts from an isotropic antenna. This effective power level is reached by radiating a smaller total power in a beam approximately 30 degrees wide towards the earth. So actually here we are not using the isotropic antennas, but that can be achieved. How it can be achieved? By radiating a smaller total power approximately at 30 degrees wide angle to the earth. So please remember this 26.8 decibel watts at a transmitted power of 26.8 decibel watts. But this is not received same at the receiving. There will be some losses. So that we will learn next. The radiated power level was chosen to provide a SNR sufficient for tracking of the signal by a receiver on the earth with an unobstructed view of the satellite. So in our previous class, we have learned about the power spectrum is at a lower level than the noise. Then we are using the technique of despreading. Despreading will increase the power level of the received signal strength. Then we can use an narrowband filtering effect. And here, we have to provide sufficiently high SNR. If not, it may be suppressed by the noise. So the chosen power has been, but it is criticized by other parties because especially for the military purposes and some heavy base stations and in urban canyons, this power may not be sufficient. That is 26.8 decibel watts power may not be sufficient for serving all the needs. So in future we may expect powers more than this. Still this is under research. Then what are the losses? This is very, very important. The first one is the free space loss factor, and second one is the atmospheric loss factor. When the signal is transmitted from a transmitter, before it reaches to the receiver, there are two losses encountered. One is called the free space loss factor. It loses the power density due to the spherical spreading, because the signal is being, the satellite is being rotating in a elliptical orbit. So Earth is also rotating around itself. Because of this, there will be some free space less, and it is given by lambda by 4 pi r square. R is the meters from transmitting antenna compared to the value normalized to the unity, and lambda is the wavelength of that particular signal. So FSLF is the free space loss factor, is the fractional power density at a distance r meters from the transmitting antenna compared to a value normalized to unity at the distance lambda by 4 pi meters, at the distance lambda by 4 pi meters from the antenna face center. And this is for roughly, for these values, this is around -182.4 decibels. So this is decreased among the from the 26.8 decibel watts. In addition to this, there is one more loss factor that is called as the atmospheric loss factor. It is about 2 decibels, as the signal is being attenuated by the atmosphere itself. So total received power is EIRP minus FSLF, effective isotropic radiated power minus free space loss factor minus atmospheric loss factor, then it is coming to around -157.6 decibel watts. So this is the received power. And how do we know how to measure the antenna gain, how much antenna gain should be maintained, and what will be the received minimum received signal power at this gain? So a typical GPS antenna with right hand circular polarization, it is using a right hand circular polarization and a hemispherical pattern, has about 3 decibel of gain related to an isotropic antenna. The minimum received signal power for such an antenna is about 3 decibels larger. So using the isotropic antenna, we are losing some of the power radiated, and to avoid this, we are using a hemispherical pattern. We are using a circular polarization, right hand circular polarization with hemispherical pattern. Please remember these two, very important for objective use, so that we could get 3 decibels larger. And the next concept is signal acquisition and tracking. Please make a note of this, all these points. So what is signal acquisition and tracking? So first and most important step in the signal acquisition and tracking is to determine which satellites are visible to the antenna, to which antenna are receiving antenna. So GPS receiver, of course, whoever is using mobile phones are GPS receivers in that. For military purpose, there will be separate GPS receivers. To that antenna, some satellites are visible. How many satellites are, which satellites are visible to that? First step is this. The second step is to determine the approximate Doppler shift of the each visible satellite. How that will be done? By comparing it with the two carrier frequencies. And third step is to search for the signal both in frequency and in C by A code phase. So at what frequency it is received and what is the phase of the C by A code. And fourth step is to detect the presence of the signal and confirm the detection. After doing all these steps, we have to detect whether the signal is present there or not, and it should be confirmed by the receiver. Once it is confirmed by the receiver, the next step is log on to the track the C by A code. Once we confirm that there is a signal which is being sent and at the receiving station, we have to walk to track the C by A code first. Then log on to the and track the carrier also, C by A code as well as the carrier, and perform the data bit synchronization. These are to be synchronized. Then perform the process of demodulation and receive the navigation data. The navigation data actually transmitted at 50 bits per second. That is using a BPSK technique. So here also the 50 bits per second navigation data will be received. So these are the 8 steps in signal acquisition and tracking. Is that clear? Any doubts up to this? So once again, I'm revising. So to determine which satellites are visible to the antenna first. Second, to determine the
approximate Doppler shift of the each visible satellite. Third, search for the signal both in the frequency and also in the C by A code phase. Fourth, to detect the presence of the signal and confirm its detection. Once it is detected, the next step is lock onto and track the C by A code. You have to track the C by A code, obviously. Then you have to track the carrier in the next step. Then perform the bit synchronization. And final step is the demodulate and retrieve the navigation data. That is with a data rate of 50 bits per second. So this is very, very important. And after this, how we extract the information for navigation? The navigation message is consisting of navigation data. But how do we extract the information for navigation purpose? For navigation purpose, what are required? That we will extract. So the essential information in the signal needed for navigation solution is at hand. This information can be classified into three categories. The first one is information needed to determine the signal transmission time. First and most important is we need to know what is the transmission time. That means at what time the signal has started from the satellite, then at what time it is received, and it will give time of travel. Because to know the distance, we have to know the time of travel and velocity. Of course, speed or velocity we know, because RF signal travels with the speed of light, and time calculation is very, very important. Second is the information needed to establish the position and velocity of the each satellite. What is the almanac data of the satellite and what is the ephemeris of that signal, that are to be known. And third one is, because it is traveling over a multipath, there may be a Doppler shift. So we have to find out the pseudo range and the Doppler measurements that are made by the receiver. By these three information, we will be able to know, we will be able to accurately navigate the receiver. Then there are some theoretical considerations in the pseudo range and pseudo ranging and frequency estimation. So, of course, there is GPS receiver may be well designed, but there is a major source of error within that. What is that? That is called as a of course, this will be there in normal receivers also. In our analog communication receivers or digital communication receiver, there is always a thermal noise. Always you have to maintain a higher SNR to suppress the noise, any kind of noise. And to estimate that the thermal noise, it is using a separate theory that is called as the estimation theory. Of course, details of this not needed for us. Out of the curiosity, I'm opening this topic. So theoretical bounds on errors in estimating the code-based and carrier-based pseudo range, as well as the Doppler frequency estimates, have been developed with an interfering branch of mathematical statistics called as the estimation theory. Of course, some of you might be knowing this. And this uses two techniques. One is called as the maximum likelihood, and another one is called as a minimum variance unbiased estimator. So these two techniques are used by this estimation theory to know the estimate the thermal noise or any kind of noise it is. Then it can get the appropriate signal strength at the receiving end, right? So with this, the unit 2 completes. Any doubts? Please speak, guys. Any doubts till now? So entire unit is completed. And questions are also ready with you, both descriptive and objective. So much more time we have. Okay, we have about 20 minutes of time. So we will see the unit 3.
So next is everything about the design aspects of the GPS receiver. So I will open the syllabus for you also. This. So unit 3 is GPS receivers and data errors. First part is GPS receiver. What is the construction details of the GPS receivers? Of course, the GPS receivers are slightly different from your ordinary receivers. And continuation of this is the data errors. What are the various sources of errors? What are the various types of errors? What are the causes for them? And how to overcome them, or how to adjust them, or how to correct them at the receiver? These are the contents of the unit 3. So first, all of you please draw the block diagram of the GPS receiver. This is the block diagram of the GPS receiver. Please draw this. So first, receiving antenna. So after receiving the signal, it will be passed through a bandpass filter. Unable to see the shared screen. Now is it okay? Are you able to view the share? Now I shared it. Go with the new share. Is it okay? So I began the GPS receivers and data errors, and this is the block diagram of the GPS receiver, and it is very frequently asked question in the university examinations. Please try to draw it very clearly. It looks like an ordinary receiver, but there are a few changes to be noted. So this is divided into 3 stages. First one is the RF stage. Second one is the IF stage. And next is the second IF. IF stage is divided into 2 stages. Please draw it. I'll wait for a few moments. This is a typical GPS receiver. Of course, depending on the type of navigation required, slightly receivers will differ. But in a nutshell, these are the common things for all kinds of GPS receivers. So this is standard GPS receiver structure. So this is the block diagram of a GPS receiver. Have you drawn the diagram? Say yes or no. Are you still drawing? Hello, are you there in the class? Are you still drawing or completed? Who is this XB2106? What is this number? Who is this guy XB2106? Turn on your video. Who is this guy XB2106? Right. So let us understand the GPS receiver, a typical GPS receiver, and its functioning. So it's been divided into three stages. First one is the RF stage, second one is the first IF stage, and third one is the second IF stage, and finally through A to D conversion it will be given for the output production purpose. So RF stage consists of a bandpass filter antenna. So the signal is received by the antenna first, then the received signal is passed through the bandpass filter, then it is amplified, because while traveling the signal energy power may be lost. To overcome that, this is amplified before it is passed to the mixer. So of course, as usual to a conventional receiver, it is passed through a mixer. So for mixer, there should be two frequencies. One is the original modulated signal frequency, and another is the generated from the reference oscillator. That is for the frequency synthesis purpose. So reference oscillator, or we can call it as a local oscillator frequency. So local oscillator frequency will be equal to that of the carrier frequency. When these two are multiplied, will generate a signal. And this is again passed to the band pass filter, again amplified, and again given to the second mixer. Entire this is the intermediate frequency stage. Again, in the second mixer stage also, the same local oscillator frequency is given to that. So two stages of mixing is done here. Then it is passed to the bandpass filter again, again amplified, and finally given to the A to B converter, because the information received all is in the form of a analog form. That is in the form of an analog signal, because the L1 carrier and L2 carriers are analog in nature. Even though it is a digital modulation, this is an analog form. Then we need to use an A to D converter. Of course, you might have already studied different types of A to D converters. Of course, whichever is fastest and whichever is more accurate and whichever is giving more precise values, that can be used here. And after passing through the A to D converter, the output is obtained. The output obtained will be synchronized with the frequency synthesizer, and what are the different activities that are to be done after converting into A to D conversion? What are the outputs of the A to D converter? The first one is code acquisition and tracking. Of course, whatever we have learned in the topic of signal acquisition and tracking, all the activities, there are 8 steps. All the 8 steps will be present in the receiving end. So code acquisition and tracking, carrier acquisition and tracking, and message bit synchronization, and navigation message demodulation. After that, code pseudo ranging or carrier pseudo ranging. Pseudo ranging is done in the initial stage. Then delta range measurements. It is done with the two carriers. There will be some difference, and that is also is measured. That is called as the delta range measurement. Then it is passed through the navigation processing. Of course, that is done by a process called as the Kalman filtering. Of course, it is not a matter of importance here, but the technique is called as the Kalman filtering. Kalman is the name of the mathematician. Kalman filtering is done. Then it needs some external inputs from the ground station itself, like INS, inertial navigation, then altimeter, LORAN C, and clock aiding. These are the inputs, local inputs that are required for Kalman filtering. And it may also encounter some of the interrupts. Then after completely carrying out the navigation process, the output is generated. So what we expect generally, the output of a navigation means what is the position of the user. If it is in the moment, with which velocity it is moving, and at what time it is detected, and is there any faults, and is this detected and isolated. The user is to be detected, and after detecting, that has to be isolated. Without isolation, you cannot recognize exactly the longitudes and latitudes of a user. Longitudes and latitudes of a user. This is all about the GPS receiver in a nutshell. Okay, I try to draw it totally, because this is very, very important. GPS receiver block diagram, very frequently asked question. Once the signal is passed to the A to D converter, it will be converted into the digital nature. So that's why it is called as the digitized intermediate frequency signal. And that is
From that, we will extract code acquisition and tracking, carrier acquisition and tracking, and bit synchronization, then navigation message demodulation, then code or carrier pseudo ranging, then delta range measurements. Finally, we will give into the navigation process. That is a technique of Kalman filtering, which will use some external inputs from INS, altimeter, LoRaWAN-C, and clock aiding. These are all local satellites. Then finally, the navigation output is produced, which will include position, velocity, time, if any faults, detection, and isolation of the user. That is to be tracked. Is that clear? Any doubts in the GPS receivers? All right. In our next class, we will see about the each one in detail. So what is the function of each one and how it enables that, and what type of antenna used to be used, and what type of antenna polarization is to be used, and how antenna design is done, and what are the different design considerations of a GPS antenna. This is very, very important, because the normal antennas cannot be used for the GPS receivers. The specialized antennas are used, and specialized radiation patterns are used for that. So all the details we will see in next class. So I may take one more class before the second week. If possible, tomorrow I'll take one class. Be ready for that. Don't go outside and don't be out of station. Say yes or no. So keep preparing for the mid exam from today onwards. Thank you for today, and I'm winding up the class.